Thank you, Professor. Good morning, everybody. So thanks, Philips, for inviting me for this symposium and to share the results of the research we've been doing last 5 years, 4 years with them. And we will talk about the advances on 3D neuroimaging, the Angio Suite to fast treatment of LVOs. Those are our disclosures. So 2020 was a crazy year. Thanks, Professor Mohe, for bringing a live conference in Lausanne again. And was a year that, you know, nothing else after that, nothing else surprised us, not even this picture of this guy walking and a car burning. So I think we are coming out, fortunately, from a year like that. And in that perspective, I want to share with you this case. This is a 58-year-old patient presenting aphasia and right hemiparesis. And the patient had an NIHSS of 15, and at 10 p.m., there was no CT available in the community hospital. So she was transferred to an EVT site 2.5 hours. And then arriving there, there was a code blue in the CT, and there was no staff to run the elective CT. What would you do? Tudor, I know your answer already. But
you can change the color of the color of the code. If you move from blue to red, you can change the color and the situation is different.
So consider MRI, direct to Angio for imaging, then procedure, transfer to another hospital, patient should wait on and for the CT to be available, or direct to Angio and no imaging. Raul, what would you do?
You know the answer. That's why you're doing with trust, direct to Angio.
Tudor, what would you do?
It's a no-brainer.
Okay.
Direct to Angio.
Direct to Angio.
And come to Bicêtre.
To Bicêtre. So if you come, you do a cone beam CT, and if you have this quality of imaging, honestly, who has a cone beam CT that has something? I mean, this is a very old cone beam CT, but who has an image that is not great? That you, it's almost, I mean, you can't make a judgment based on this imaging. Who has an imaging like that? Still a lot of people. Huh? So can we make a decision on that?
Actually, I believe you can. You can see if you do a non-contrast CT and an expert CT, even old technology, we did that in our center. You can exclude the hemorrhage. You can find a proximal occlusion. And you can make a decision by purely excluding people with malignant, completely absent collaterals. Because if there are any collaterals present here, there is a live tissue.
Okay.
All right. So the only thing that this scan doesn't give you in terms of information compared to the modern flat panel CT is whether you can give TPA in this patient, okay? Because if the patient has an NIH of 15, right, and has a scan that looks like that, you know that the problem is gonna be...
Tudor, why you say that? What is the exclusion criteria for IVTPA? There is no aspect exclusion criteria for IVTPA.
No,
there
hemorrhage.
Is no greater than a third of the MCA.
So for a scan like this, I am a bit reluctant to give IVTPA with a bad scan.
But you agree that there is no exclusion criteria for IVTPA, that it's based on parenchymal image other than a large, extensive, definite area of hypodensity.
Yeah, if you know that it's an ischemic stroke, but you may miss a small subarachnoid hemorrhage, you may miss a small parenchymal hemorrhage. So I'm not comfortable with a scan like this to give IVTPA. Others may be, but the bottom line is the patient has a stroke or a stroke mimic, but he doesn't have an intracerebral hemorrhage that accounts for this deficit.
Yeah, that's the point. So even if you are willing to treat, if it's a patient that you know that you will do a thrombectomy, the a scan like that is not comfortable. And this is why I think we should all work, and Philips, and we've been working with them to actually get an imaging that this is kind of the current cone beam CT that we have. We still have it as prototypes, as a research project, but we will be demonstrating what actually was done to get the CT to this level of quality. So the Angio Suites, we see that for hemorrhagic diseases, you could see on the cases from Bicêtre and the cases from Toronto, we can get beautiful pictures of devices, but stroke has been kind of this pattern of this quality of cone BCT for stroke or for parenchymal imaging. And the problem is that it's inherent of the technique as well. So you have the conventional CT that has thin slices that rotate and go through different axes, and the cone that will be a single projection. So you will lose a lot of tissue when you are actually rotating the source of X-ray through the head of the patient. And if you think from a stroke patient perspective, you add patient motion, different artifacts, they scatter, and also the acquisition time that is longer than a regular CT, that will also contribute to motion artifacts. So Philips did five big improvements. They got a new detector to improve the quality of the parenchymal imaging, increase the acquisition speed, improve the bone beam hardening correction, created a dual axis trajectory, so the C arm will not rotate only circular, it will rotate with an AP and an anterior and posterior inclination to actually change the axis of the rotation, and also developed a motion artifact algorithm. So we enrolled 273 patients through 3 years of study, and we did 310 cone beam CTs. So this is the distribution of the patients. And the first study, we actually tried to evaluate the 20 seconds imaging with a new circular scans with the new detector that will be commercial soon, or it's already in some centers, increase acquisition and the bone beam hardening correction. So they increased the density of the scintillators. They did a lot of technical changes on the detector, and they also decreased to 50% the acquisition time. And this is an example, a 78-year-old patient that had a 20-second scan, first generation. You can see here in the lower imaging, the bone beam hardening artifact that prevents us to see the medial fossa. A lot of bone hardening preventing to evaluate or to assess the cortex very well. And the second generation scans already with improvements, and we can compare with the CT, and it's all pretty good. So we are going towards the CT rather than going back to that first generation scans that we saw at the beginning. So analyzing those scans, we actually, the second generation scans with the new detector and with the fast acquisition could improve the analysis of the imaging in at least 50-60%. And was statistically significant compared to the first generation in terms of noise, artifact reduction, and gray and white matter differentiation. So this is an example. The beam hardening is what is flagrant. So we have scans now that you can assess the cortex. Sometimes most subarachnoid hemorrhoids we will not be able to see. Now with this optimized scans, we can. And also we had those bands on the cortex that, you know, sometimes if they were, if the patient was turned the head, you would mix it for, you would confuse with a stroke. This is also improved and fixed with all the other artifacts. So the second study was to evaluate the circulars and the butterfly, which the dual axis scan. So we had patients doing both, and we compared the artifacts, and this is a list of the artifacts that we were analyzing. And when we speak about beam hardening, is this kind of artifact that interferes with the medial and the posterior fossa and that is caused by a high density bone. And undersampling is this kind of artifact that has this ray aliasing with those streaks that are actually creating an artifact on the parenchyma. Inhomogeneity is like this shadow of the brain one side. That can be pretty bad, and you are unable despite of the quality of the imaging, if you have this artifact to tell if that is stroke or not. Cone beam effect prevents the analysis of the cortex, patient motion we all seeing, and metal artifacts is when the scan or the patient has the head rotated too much posteriorly. So in this phase, we could observe that the butterfly actually reduced significantly the beam hardening and the cone beam effect. So the top and the posterior fossa we could see better, and the metallic artifacts were also way reduced because the scans, when they were crossing the face, they would actually make an inclination and they will actually be focusing from AP and lateral on the same axis of a regular scan. So those are examples, the circular scan with the beam hardening artifact, and here the butterfly, you can see that you can analyze the posterior fossa, look for bleedings as well, and here the medial fossa, that was also the flagrant difference between the two types of scans. And analyzing this phase and those scans, we actually had some of those inhomogeneities that we didn't understand, and we performed an experiment with a phantom that we actually found out that the inhomogeneity is a problem of the center of the patient. And if you put the phantom a little bit to the right, you will have this artifact, to the left, this artifact, and the patient on the center, you'll have a parenchymal imaging. And this is a good learning for us. Cone beam CT, you have to perfectly center the patient to compared to the flat detector to actually have prevent the occurrence of this artifact. And the third phase of the study was the motion artifact correction. Philips actually used an algorithm that was based on reconstruction of arbitrary trajectories. So the patient moves and then you have the image in different axes. They actually took every frame and they made a simulation instead of what is the reality. The head moves and the scan stays in a position. They made an assumption that the head is static and that the scan moves. And they used different equations. This is the reference of the technique. And they did it multiple times until get a motion artifact correction. And from those 310 cone beam CTs, we applied the motion artifact correction to all of them. And we actually created a scale of from 0 to 4 based on the diagnosis to actually also calculate the degree of motion. 0 is no motion, 1 is a little bit of motion, but it still could be diagnosed. 2 is moderate, that you can diagnose a hemorrhage, but the stroke wouldn't be that optimal. And the severe is a non-diagnostic scan. And we could find 51% of stroke patients in our center that are under conscious sedation will have motion, which is what we could expect on a stroke population. And the motion compensated could fix the motion artifacts in most of them. So after the motion compensation, we had it increased to 91% of good scans with improved motion artifact. And these are a couple of examples. This severe motion can now be actually almost known, be a diagnostic scan. This is another severe case, and you see, this is the algorithm that runs, and it doesn't take too much computation time. It's actually very fast, and when it will be commercial, almost at the time of the processing of the scan, you will process the motion artifact, and you will have those images almost instantaneously. Those are some cases that improved significantly, but were not completely excluded. And this is a moderate case. The moderate and the mild cases, the motion artifact eliminates completely any motion artifact. So this is a nice technology because this is a problem that we have recurrent patients with carotid strokes, left side, they all move. And this is a big improvement on the imaging for assessment of stroke. And before processing and after processing, we could increase the value of the diagnosis from 50 to 76%. And the motion artifact from 51 to 93%. So when we think that with this quality of imaging and with this improved setup, we can exclude blood, we can now detect core and ischemia and analyze the parenchyma, but we can also add contrast, as Raul, Professor Murray suggested before, to look for collaterals and occlusions. So this is also possible. We have a perfusion-like cone beam CT that on the Philips machine, you actually inject contrast and you have a bolus and you do an early and a late phase. And you have those dual scans that are coupled and you have the same acquisition after the bolus of contrast. And you have the maps, you have an early and a late map, and you have a late minus early map that we are trying to correlate with other perfusion methods to understand how we will interpret those images. So this, for example, is a patient with a right M1 clot that had this late minus early phase, and compared to the rapid CTP, it almost correlates to a Tmax between 6 and 8 in terms of hyperperfusion. And this is a patient that had a right MCA clot, and you can see here the core on the rapid, and we can see the core on the late phase. So the late phase correlates more with the core. The late minus early correlates more with the hyperperfused area. So this is another example, left M2s, similar behavior. And here the late phase correlates with the post-procedure CT, demonstrating the core of the lesion. This is a 72-year-old patient, 2.5 hour stroke onset. This is the rapid hyperperfused area, core of 28. And you can see here the correlation with the imaging. And if we put those two, you can see that the early phase correlates with the hyperperfused area. The late phase correlates with the core. And both correlates with the Tmax between 6 to 8. So we reanalyzed this patient. And on the following day, this is what we had on the late phase. And it correlates with the post-op CT. So still learning, still studying, still assessing. And we can also detect with the same scans the occlusions. And we can reconstruct and have them actually using even as a roadmap, as you can see in this case that did the CT right before the angio, and the image correlate very well in the 95+ in terms of occlusion site, with the advantage that with the cone beam CT, you know the clot length because you have the collateral as well. So are we ready for prime time? So I think we do. How much still we should improve? I think every minute counts. I think we should try to improve and gain time and gain and improve the workflow. I think I just can reinforce what Tudor, Raul, Mark are proposing on bringing the patient to the angio. But I prefer to be comfortable with images that I'm showing to you after those improvements. And I'm finalizing the talk and speaking about how fast we should go. I found this video on LinkedIn this week. It's about the pit stop for Ferrari. How long do you think is the pit stop on Ferrari? 16, 8, 3 seconds or 20 seconds?
3 seconds.
3 seconds? Wow, that fast?
Italian.
Yeah, I actually thought that was 8 seconds, and then, yeah, 3 seconds, the Italians know everything. So this is what I think we should be working for, and I think bringing the patient direct to angio makes perfect sense, but having the best and the good imaging to assess the patient will give you confidence, particularly on the cases that, you know, the occlusion or the case is not obvious. There's a lot of research and literature. But my summary is that Philips did a great job on improving the imaging and the quality of the imaging on the ExpressCT for parenchymal imaging. From this first generation, we are now with very diagnostic images and close to the regular CT. So I think they are ready, and we should be ready to direct to Angio. Thank you for your attention. Questions?
Yeah, so quick, great talk, excellent. So this is not commercially available yet, or is?
No, some of them are a lot, still prototypes. So most of this study was done with a prototype. We had a special approval to do on the study. Uh-huh. The centers that have now are in or in WeTrust, or like Professor Murray, are part of a study to do the second phase of validation of the technology.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's possible to put a aspect, automated via VZAOs or some type of artificial intelligence aspect score on those images. It look beautiful.
You saw the quality.
So you can do so. You can have that one and the aspect score immediately available when you do the scan.
You can. The images are very, very close, and I saw Raul looking to the motion images. And a little bit incredible. That's the motion correction is pretty impressive. So some of those images that were non-diagnostic comes with no artifact almost. So that's a big improvement, because even with faster scans, those scans will take 7, 8 seconds, 10 seconds, depending on the dose. And for a stroke patient, 10 seconds is a lot. So compared to 2 seconds or less than a second that you do a regular CT. So.
One thing that I think it's worth highlighting, right, Vitor, is there are many pitfalls to the acquisition. I see the image from Bissetri, I see your images, and in my own center, oftentimes I can't get those same images. But then when we look into why, there are clear reasons. As Vitor said, you have to center well. You shouldn't have air gap above the head, right? And you need to calibrate the machine, right, Vitor? Can you comment on the machine calibration?
Yeah, that's a good point. So the CT, you need to have, depending on the generation that you have, you need to calibrate to prevent that circular artifact. I'm not even talking about it, because we calibrate the machine every day for the study. So if you calibrate the machine every day, you see that you don't have those circular artifacts. But if you don't calibrate, you will have those circular artifacts. That's added to that. That's very important. We have a hand holder for stroke patients. So this is very important to reduce the motion. And the centering is something that, since we did that experiment to understand the shadowing, the inhomogeneity artifact, we actually have now a marker. And we are trying to create a laser marker. We are telling Philips to put a laser to actually guide the technologists to center well. So,
Vitor, two questions. Number one, how did you get the old and the new scan in the same patient, in somebody who needs to have a thrombectomy or has a large vessel occlusion?
Yeah, so that's a good point. The RB gave us a tough time to approve, but as any new technology, you want to improve the quality of the imaging, and we need to compare. I cannot come with a new imaging and compare. So those patients, most were transferred from another center or had TPA that we usually do cone beam CT before the Angio. And we were preparing the patient while we were preparing all the material. The technologists would do the CT themselves. So we had the protocols they would do. The patient would do this and that protocol. So we usually, patient would get two types of Express CT, one after the
but
other.
But it's the same Angio equipment?
Yeah.
Oh, same Angio equipment, but two types of Express CT. Two.
Yeah.
Okay.
Two acquisitions.
That makes sense. Two acquisitions.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay. It's a good point, because we were applying for the more or less same kind of protocol. I was afraid to apply that for the ethics committee.
Yeah.
And Vanessa Chalumeau is working on this project. And finally, and quite surprisingly, they have understood that it's for the... So we will be losing probably 5 minutes for a certain amount of patients to gain time afterwards. So it was accepted by the ethic committee to not only spend more time, but to have more X-ray being delivered to the patient for the two
stents. If it's the same angio equipment, it makes sense. It's
The dose doesn't increase too much. So in Canada, there is a limit that the IRB considered that added dose would be unacceptable. We are way below. So the CT studies are way 10 times, 20 times higher. And we have to compare the image. And so now we are doing a second phase study that we are comparing. We are now lowering the dose. So that's the future of what we are doing on research with them now. And now RB had no problem even, went through like smoothly.
Right, so the second question is, do you think that, I mean, not do you think, what's the situation with your stroke neurologists? Are they comfortable giving TPA or TNK based on flat panel imaging? Because I think that's gonna be a big factor for this.
Yeah,
development.
Yeah, so I can speak from the two hospitals. So I just left the Toronto West and at St. Mike's. At the Toronto West, and the neurologists would see the CT and would decide with us. And most of them were very comfortable because the diagnostic neuroradiologists were very comfortable with those cone beam scans. At St. Mike's, there is a radiologist at the hospital that report the emergency scans. So, and these guys are very comfortable with those cone beam CTs. I was surprised we don't need a CT. So now we got the buy-in from the radiology team, and that gives confidence to the neurology team.
It is very important that you publish this data, that there's as much data as possible published, so that others are, share this level of comfort.
So study one is published, European Journal of Radiology, study two under review. So if you got a review of something like that.
No, but please. Specifically safety of TPA administration when selection is ruled out on cone beam.
Okay.
That's really important.
Yeah, we can get from that 272 a good 50 patients that the decision was made on that.
And that was explored in Mark's study. Maybe Mark can make a comment about that. But there was no safety concerns in the patients that got TPA with cone beam CT.
Right, but I think that, there's 7 cases here, 7 cases there. I'm sorry, 70 cases here, 70 cases there. I think when people see 70 cases, they're not going to be that impressed. If you see 1,000 cases, it's a different story.